Good morning all. Today I am going to start glomerulonephritis. My topic for today is classification and pathogenesis of glomerulonephritis. But before that, I will start with normal. Now I'll be talking on normal kidney, histology, renal glomerular disease, classification, pathogenesis, and clinical features. So this is the normal kidney. What you are seeing, there are right and left kidneys which are connected with ureter, and then it will go into the bladder, then urethra, and it is having a blood supply, that is inferior vena cava, aorta, renal arteries, which will again divide into renal arteries and renal vein, then again it will divide into iliac vein and iliac arteries. Cut section of the kidney, it shows there are two, outside it is the renal capsule, inside renal cortex, medulla, and then comes the renal pelvis. This renal medulla, it is divided into, this is renal pyramid, then it comes into papilla. From there, it will form the minor calyx, which will join to form major calyx, and from there, it will come into renal pelvis. So this is the parts of the cut section of the kidney, what you are seeing. And this kidney, it is supplied by the renal artery and renal vein, which further divides into interlobar, segmental, arcuate arteries, and from the arcuate arteries, you are seeing the, from the arcuate arteries, it will come out as afferent arteriole. Okay, this afferent arteriole, it will again divide into multiple capillaries, which forms the, that is around 5 to 6 tufts of capillaries, and that forms the glomerulus. And again from this glomerulus, that is capillaries, from capillaries, it will come out as efferent arteriole. Understood? From the renal artery, it will divide into intersegmental, interlobar, arcuate arteries. From arcuate arteries, which is present in the cortex, this arcuate arteries, and each part of this renal cortex, you can see this glomerulus. And so from the arcuate artery, it comes into afferent arteriole, and that afferent arteriole will divide into multiple capillaries, that is around 5 to 6 capillary tufts, we call that, and that again they will join inside and come out as efferent arterioles, and this is called as, this tuft, what is present, that is capillary tuft, is called as glomerulus. See, I'm talking about glomerulus because this is the main structure, main important unit of the kidney. Because of the damage of this, leads to lot of clinical features. So this is glomerulus, important part. Structure, and this glomerulus outside, it is the Bowman's capsule. From the Bowman's capsule, it will come out as proximal convoluted tubule. From there, it will form limb of, descending limb of Henle, loop of Henle, ascending loop of Henle, and then it will form the distal convoluted tubule, from there collecting duct. So this is the structure of the nephron. This all together, it is called as nephron, and there are around 1 million nephrons in the kidney. Okay, so this glomerulus, this capillaries, they have a glue called as mesangial matrix, and which is having mesangial cells. So this, coming to glomerulus, now structure of the glomerulus. So as I told you, glomerulus, it is nothing but this afferent arterioles will divide into capillaries, and that there are some 5 to 6 capillaries, I told you, or it might be up to 8 capillary tufts, and that capillary tufts, it has a capillary wall. Okay, I will just show you the picture. Capillary wall, that capillary wall, it has a fenestrations. Okay, that there are nothing but fenestrations, is nothing but holes, which are 70 to 100 nanometers holes. And below that, it is surrounded by glomerular basement membrane. Okay, this capillary wall, it is surrounded by glomerular basement membrane. And this basement membrane has 3 layers, lamina rara interna, lamina densa, lamina rara externa, then visceral epithelial cells, mesangial cells, which will contract, proliferate, and it is having collagen and matrix secretions. Okay, this mesangial cells. So that is comprising of capillaries. That is, glomerulus is made up of capillaries, basement membrane, visceral epithelial cells, which is also called as podocytes, mesangial cells. These are the structure of the glomerulus, which I will show you the picture. So here what you are seeing, this is the glomerulus. I think your pointer is not available. but still you can just read on this. I'll start from afferent arteriole. Okay, from afferent arteriole, then it will divide into capillary tufts within the glomerulus, and this glomerulus is out. This capillary tufts and the mesangium is present, and outside that is the Bowman's space, which I forgot. This is the Bowman's capsule, and outside this Bowman's capsule, there is a type of epithelial cells. They are called as parietal epithelial cells, and the covering of the this capillaries, they are called as visceral epithelial cells or the podocytes. And these capillaries are lined by endothelial cells, okay, and they are covered by a basement membrane. This is the structure, and within, and these are embedded in the glue called as mesangium. That mesangium is consisting of mesangial matrix and mesangial cells. So this whole structure is glomerulus, and then it will come out as this capillary tufts. Again, they join and come out as efferent arteriole. And this is the distal, adjacent. You can see this will continue as proximal tubules, and later on it will come out as distal convoluted tubules. Okay, then that whole structure is nephrons. So this is the structure what I'm talking about. That is endothelial cells, visceral. There are two types of epithelial cells. Visceral epithelial cells and parietal epithelial cells. Between the parietal epithelial cells and visceral epithelial cells, there is a space called as Bowman's space. Now next is, what is the function of this glomerulus? So as you know, there is around 1700 ml of the blood which is formed, that will convert into one, that blood will convert into 1 liter of urine. So main excretion of the urine is by, from the blood it will filtrate, from the plasma it will filtrate and forms the 1 liter of urine. So that urine will get collected in the Bowman's capsule from this glomerulus, and then that will go into the proximal tubules, and that there is something called as glomerular filtration membrane. Okay, so what is glomerular filtration membrane? I will tell you in the this next picture. So glomerular, one more picture. What I was telling you is, this is the tufts of capillaries. Okay, there are 5-6 capillaries. Here you can see 2 capillaries. They are inner lined by endothelium, and outside it is the basement membrane, and outermost it is the, these are the epithelial cells, that is visceral epithelial cells or the podocytes. And these podocytes have the food processes, which we call, these are called as food processes. Okay, and inside it is the space, this is RBCs. And so, and these are situated in the glue called as mesangium, in that mesangial cells and the matrix. So this is the structure of the glomerulus. So mesangial cell, mesangial matrix, endothelial cell, basement membrane, epithelial cell. Now glomerular filtration membrane, what I was talking was, it comprises of epithelial cell, basement membrane, endothelial cell. All these three together, it forms the glomerular filtration membrane. So once the blood containing the constituents enters into this capillaries, there it gets filtered, and only plasma will come out through this membrane. And from there again, urine will, from this plasma, urine will come out, and that will go into the Bowman's space. And rest all calcium, other ions, and whatever is has to be absorbed, it will get absorbed, and there and whatever has to be excreted, it will get excreted into the urine. So this is the structure of glomerular capillaries. So this is one more structure. This is the glomerulus, and these capillaries are in the form of tufts. Okay, this is the structure what I was telling. So you can appreciate here, how many capillaries are there here? 1, 2, 3. This is, we will take it as 1. So 4 capillary tufts are there, and these capillary tufts are present within the glue called as mesangium, with mesangial cell and matrix, and they are covered by, outside there is a cell called as, see, just adjacent to this capillaries you are seeing the visceral epithelial cells, and there is a space that is called as Bowman's space. Outside is the parietal epithelial cells, and these visceral epithelial cells have the podocyte, it is also called as podocytes. It has a food processes. You can see it has entrapped this capillaries by its food processes. Okay, so it is present, and between this food processes you can see this membrane. Okay, and this is the capillary, and that capillary is lined by endothelial cells, and there is a basement membrane. You can see this is the basement membrane, glomerular basement membrane it is called as, and these are the fenestrations within the epithelium. So these, through this, within the endothelium, so these fenestrations through which, these are the fenestrations, and beyond, after that is the glomerular basement membrane, then comes the visceral epithelial cells. So this all together forms the glomerular filtration membrane. Through this, urine will come out through in the Bowman space, and from there it will go into the proximal convoluted tubules. So this structure is very important for the diseases of, to learn the diseases of glomerulus, you should know this structure very thoroughly. So RBCs will not get entrapped. See, this is a 70 to 90 nanometers and or 100 nanometers. So in this, RBCs will not get trapped. So it will be within the capillaries. So it will not come out into the urine. Okay, in the urine, you are not seeing the RBCs because the size is bigger compared to this fenestration. So urine, you are just seeing the few constituents of the urines. So this is one more structure which I was telling you. RBC, this is the capillary. Outside is the visceral epithelial cells. This is parietal cells. This is the Bowman space where you are seeing this. Urine will come out through this. This is the glomerular, that red color, what you are seeing is the glomerular basement membrane. And this is the epithelial endothelial cells with fenestrations. And this is the mesangial cells. So this, and these are the food processes. Okay, this is the normal structure of the glomerulus. So next is, this is very important for your entrance as well as understanding the depth of this this thing. So what I was telling, you have now understood that this is, here you can see the capillaries. In this capillary is lined by the endothelial cells. This is the basement membrane. And on the basement membrane, you are seeing the, this is nothing but food processes of the podocyte or visceral epithelial cells. So there are two food processes, that is visceral epithelial cells, food processes are there. Within these food processes, there are certain proteins named as podocin and CD2AP and actin filaments, which are present within these food processes. And these two food processes are connected by other proteins called as nephrin molecules. So why I'm talking about this is, this all is very much important to, as the urine is coming out through this space, this is the filtration slit. So from here, the urine gets collected and it comes out, and these all molecules are important to entrap the molecules and then just pass the urine out. And any mutations in this also leads to the glomerular injury, mutation of podocin or nephrin molecules. Normal histology. This is the normal histology glomerulus, and this is the Bowman space, and these are the tubules you are seeing. Okay. Proximal and distal convoluted tubules. This is the normal histology. So this is all what I talked about, glomerulus structure. So now next, coming to the, so that was the normal glomerulus you saw. And now what are the main components of the, or diseases, there are main components in the kidneys are, it includes glomerulus, tubules, interstitium, blood vessels. So now today's topic is on diseases of glomeruli. So what is a glomerular diseases? It is a group of diseases. It affects glomerulus and inflammatory nature. It is immunologically mediated. It may be primary or secondary. So what is the definition? It's a abnormalities of glomerular function that is caused by damage to the major components of the glomerulus. As I've told, I've cleared you what are the components of the glomerulus, that is epithelium, podocytes, visceral epithelial cells, basement membrane, capillary, endothelium, mesangium. So damage manifested by an inflammatory process. Okay. So this is the glomerular diseases, what I was telling. Definition, I told you, abnormalities of glomerular function, that is the damage of these components, epithelium, basement membrane, capillary, endothelium or mesangium. It's manifested by inflammatory process. And the word glomerulonephritis, it is defined as spectrum of renal diseases of varied etiology and clinical presentations that are characterized by clinical and histological evidence of glomerular disease. Damage. So what this glomerular nephritis, as the itis we use for the inflammation, any inflammation of the tissue, we use the term as itis. So here we are going to use the term as glomerulonephritis. Okay, for the infection of the glomerulus, we call it as nephritis. And if it is the infection of the tubules, we call it as pyelonephritis. So all these terms you should know. And now other terms we use along with this glomerulonephritis, they are all same: glomerulopathy, glomerulonephritis, nephritis. So these all terms are same. Next, the term glomerulosame, as I told you, they are interchangeable. But only difference between glomerulonephritis and glomerulopathy is this: glomerulonephritis are usually associated with inflammation, such as leukocytes, antibody depositions, and complement activations. So that I will deal in the next in pathogenesis. So it can encompass the same, I told you, it's a group of disorders with clinical presentation, severity, and immunopathogenetic mechanisms. Okay. So it is recognized, glomerulonephritis is recognized as the second most commonest chronic kidney disease worldwide. In developed countries, it is third most common cause of end-stage renal disease, whereas in developing countries, it is first or second. And for every patient with clinically apparent glomerulonephritis receiving medical care, there has been additional 5 to 10 patients who are diagnosed with subclinical disease, undiagnosed, who are not diagnosed and they are in subclinical diseases are there along with the symptoms of the patients. Next. So now what are the, now coming to the topic, that is glomerulonephritis. So there are the changes, what will happen in the glomerulus that because of tissue reactions, what are the changes you see? They are called as, they are hypercellularity, basement membrane thickening, hyalinosis, sclerosis. So one by one, hypercellularity. So as the name says, hypercellularity, here you are seeing cell proliferation of mesangial cells or endothelial cells. Then there's a leukocyte infiltrations. Then formation of crescents, that is epithelial cells. So overall, what will happen once there is a glomerular injury? Once there's a glomerulus injury, what are the reactions happening in the glomerulus? So it might have an increased number of cells. It can be either mesangial cells or epithelial cells proliferation or inflammatory cells, that is leukocytes, neutrophils, monocytes can come. And if it is a epithelial proliferation along with inflammatory cells, they form a crescent formation, which you see in some forms of glomerulonephritis along with cytokines. And basement membrane thickening, there can be thickening of the capillary wall, and then hyalinization and sclerosis. Hyalinization, it is nothing but accumulation of some material, proteinaceous material, eosinophilic homogeneous material, which will get accumulated within the glomerulus, and that might damage to the further what happens because of this accumulation, it might obliterate the capillary lumen of the glomerulus and forms the sclerotic features, and later on it might damage sclerotic feature and it will the blood supply will be hampered, and later on it will damage the tubules and all, it might go for ischemia. So that it is one of the cause which will cause for hyalinization sclerosis. So these are the changes what you are seeing in the alterations once there is a glomerular injury. Now next, coming to the topic, how do you classify glomerulonephritis? Based on the clinical and disease progress, we classify them as acute glomerulonephritis, rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, or chronic glomerulonephritis, as depending upon the months, acute, chronic, and then in between is the rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. Again, in the acute glomerulonephritis, we divide them as nephrotic glomerulonephritis or nephrotic syndrome, nephritic acute glomerulonephritis or nephritic syndrome, classical type, and which further again it goes for, then it will become latent chronic glomerulonephritis with hematuria, it can cause nephrotic syndrome or hypertensive glomerulonephritis. Next, classifications based on histology. So that was the classification based on clinical features. It can be acute or chronic or rapidly progressive. Next, classification is based on the histology. As I told you, the structure of glomeruli. So like that, there are millions of glomerulus what you are seeing. And in the if the all the glomerulus is having damage, it is hampered, then it is called as diffuse. And only one glomerulus is damaged, then it is called as global. And focal of the, there are a lot of glomerulus in that few part of, only few glomeruli are injured, then it is called as focal. Segmental is one glomerulus, part of that glomerulus is damaged, then that is called as segmental. And if it is affecting the mesangium, then it is called as mesangial type of lesions. Okay. So main classification, primary glomerulopathies and systemic diseases with glomerulopathies, that is primary and secondary glomerulopathies, and then hereditary glomerulopathies. In the primary glomerulopathies, we are seeing we are seeing acute proliferative glomerulonephritis, rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, membranous glomerulopathy, minimal change disease, focal segmental sclerosis, membranoproliferative glomerulonephritis, IgA nephropathy, chronic glomerulonephritis. So these are the different types of glomerulonephritis which will be taken in the next class, which will become again in the categorized into nephritic syndrome and nephrotic syndrome, and it will be taken. And then certain diseases, there are secondary diseases like patients are having diabetes mellitus, amyloidosis, systemic lupus erythematosus. So they, because of they already patient is having this, and these might release certain proteins or certain antigens, and that leads to the lesion to the glomerulus, and that is, so it is a systemic diseases associated microscopic polyarthritis or polyangiitis, vaginous granulomatosis, Hanok-Schönlein purpura, bacterial endocarditis. Then hereditary disorders are Alport syndrome, thin basement membrane diseases, Fabry's disease. So this is the classification. So the mainly what I talked is classification. One is based on clinical features, and next is the based on their histology, that is whether it is involving one glomerulus or multiple glomeruli, based on that classification. And other classification is primary and secondary classifications. So next coming to the pathogenesis. So what are the what has damage to the glomerulus? Okay, so what causes glomerular diseases? See, most common is the immunologic origin, that is by human complexes, and metabolic stress, that is diabetic nephropathy, mechanical stress, hypertension is the next. So main so what I was telling is pathogenesis is mainly because of immunologic origin by human complexes. So what are the pathogenesis of glomerular disease? So immune mechanisms underlie the most cases of primary glomerulonephritis and many of the secondary glomerulonephritis. So now I'm coming to the pathogenesis, which is very important, and already you have studied in the hypersensitivity reactions, that is type, there are four types of hypersensitivity reactions, type 1, type 2, type 3, type 4. So this is mainly type 3 and type 2 hypersensitivity reactions that leads to the injury to the glomerulus, that is glomerulonephritis. Okay, so main coming to the immune mechanisms, it is mainly of two forms which is associated, that is antibody associated injury. So what happens whenever there is any bacteria virus which has entered into the body, it will have its antigens, and these antigens either it will go and stick on to the glomerulus, either it will go and sit on the glomerulus, and there the antibodies will come and attack. That is one form of reaction. Or other reaction is these antigens which are released by the virus or bacteria or parasites, and that will be engulfed by the antibodies, and they both bind together and form a antigen antibody deposits, and that will be circulating in the blood, and that from the circulation it might get deposited in the glomerulus. So there are two forms: injury resulting from soluble antigen antibody deposits in the glomerulus, and one more form is in situ, that is already there are some antigens which are present in the glomerulus. Either it can be from within the glomerular basement membrane antigens, or outside some antigens have come and sat into the glomerulus, and to those antigens these antibodies will come and attack, and that leads to injury to the glomerulus. So two forms: antibody associated injury, I will just tell you in detail. So what are the pathogenesis? Antibody mediated injury, then cell-mediated injury, and activation of alternative complement pathway. So as I told you, see, this is very important. This whole glomerulonephritis, what further classes will be taken will be based on this pathogenesis. So you should be thorough with this. Already it has been taken in your hypersensitivity class. So it is just a same thing which we are telling again: antibody-mediated injury, in situ immune complex deposition, and circulating immune complex deposition. So as I told you, in situ means it is already situated, antigen is present in the glomerulus, to which the antibodies will come and bind, and they both, after binding, they will cause certain reactions where inflammation will come, complement activation will occur, and that will damage to the glomerulus. And what are those antigens? It can be fixed intrinsic tissue antigens. As I told you, some antigens from the glomerular basement membrane itself, which is this glomerular basement membrane is comprised of laminin, collagens, and some other materials. So in that, main is the collagen, which is an antigen, and this antigen to this antigen, some antibodies might come and bind and cause damage to the glomerulus. And other antigens are hyemin antigens. These are also certain antigens which are present, and that will lead to one form of glomerulonephritis called as membranous nephropathy. Then mesangial antigens, some antigens which are present in mesangium might also induce the antibody deposition, that is antigen antibody complexes will cause. So this is called as in situ immune complex deposition. Then comes the circulating immune complex deposition. As I told you, circulating, as the name says, antigen antibodies are formed within the blood, and they will either, it can be endogenous antigens, some of the proteins or DNA materials. If patient is suffering from systemic lupus erythematosus, some DNA particles are released, and those DNA particles can bind with the antibodies and get deposited in the glomerulus. Or nuclear proteins, immunoglobulins, IgA. So these are all endogenous antigens. Some exogenous antigens like infectious agents, drugs, which I will tell you what are those infectious agents and drugs which will cause. So that is one of the cause. Cytotoxic antibodies are nothing but they will damage the endothelial cells. Cell-mediated immunity is one more form of, that is, one is antibody-mediated, one more is cell-mediated. It is mainly through the macrophages. Macrophages are nothing but this mesangial cells are also type of macrophages. So it can be because of macrophages as well as T cells through which the damage to the glomerulus will happen. And there is also activation of alternative complement pathway through which also it can cause the damage to the glomerulus. So circulating immune complex depositions, what happens? This antigen antibody will deposit in the glomeruli. They will bind. Then what happens once this deposition has occurred? Any foreign particle or anything enters into the body, the body will try to remove them. So what it will do? It will initially start with the activation of the inflammatory cells. Mainly initially comes the neutrophils and later on monocytes, lymphocytes. So it will start activating the, once it is formed, it will try to remove that by binding with the complement system, the coagulation cascade, and with that it will, this complement system will activate the inflammatory cells, mainly neutrophils, and those neutrophils, once it comes, it will start removing this antigen antibody, and meanwhile it will damage the glomerulus by releasing certain factors. Okay, so antigens might be exogenous, endogenous, and antibodies against antigens on the glomerular capillary membranes, so that also might get damaged to the glomerulus. Okay, so same thing what I've talked about, that is antibody directly with intrinsic tissue, antigen planted in the glomerulus, and other form is two forms of antibodies I told you, anti-glomerular basement membrane induced nephritis and hyemin nephritis. So these are the two forms. This is in situ. And circulating antigens, what can be the circulating antigens? It can be DNA, nuclear proteins, immunoglobulins, or microbial agents, that is syphilis, malaria, hepatitis C virus, hepatitis B virus, and some tumor antigens. So these might release certain antigens, and there to remove those antibodies will come. They form a complex and they will get deposited in the glomerulus. So next question is, why they have to come to the glomerulus? Once they are present in the circulation, it can go to anywhere, but why it is coming to glomerulus? So antibodies have no immunological specificity for glomerular constituents, and the complexes are localized within the, because of their physicochemical properties and hemodynamic factors. Because of that, these antigen antibodies are coming to the glomerulus and damaging the glomerulus in case of circulating antigen antibody complexes. It's mainly physicochemical property and hemodynamic factors. That is the main factors which will cause these lesions. Okay, so this is a structure, what I've already told you, glomerular structure. Part of the structure, you can see visceral epithelial cell, capillary, mesangium. Okay, so here there are two types, circulating and in situ. In circulating immune complex, again, it can get that immune complex can. So now you came to know about the, there are circulating antigen antibodies and in situ. That is, there are certain antigens present on the glomerular basement membrane, to which antibodies will bind, and that forms the antigen antibody complex. It can be either in the, if it is on the glomerular basement membrane, it is anti-glomerular basement membrane. And if it is present in the endothelial cells or the visceral epithelial cells, then it is the antigens. If they are present on that, then it is the hyemin type of antigens which you are seeing, which leads to in situ. then circulating immune complexes. See, once the circulating antigen antibodies, if it comes and deposits in the epithelial cells, then it is called as subepithelial deposits. If it comes and deposits on the endothelial, then it is called as subendothelial deposits. Okay, then mesangial deposits also it can cause. So mainly if it is endothelial, subendothelial deposits, epithelial, subepithelial deposits. So this is about the types of immune complex depositions. So this is the localizations, as I same thing what I told you, localization of immune complex in the glomerulus. It will get deposited, this immune complexes will get deposited in the subepithelium. That is first one, if you see subepithelium, this is the podocytes. Visceral other name is visceral epithelial cells. See here, this podocytes, that is subepithelial, it is called as. Here the immune complexes are deposited. Then the next comes the membrane, that is glomerular basement membrane. On that, if it gets deposited, it is epimembranous glomerular epimembranous complex. And if it is deposited on the endothelium, then it is subendothelial. And if it is deposited on the mesangium, then it is mesangial deposits. So these are the four types of deposits, and this is the basement membrane, what I've told you, lined by a lamina, and that is three layers. So same, one more picture, if you can identify, this is a glomerulus. So this is a circulate, this is the capillary, within the capillary endothelial cells, outside visceral cells, this is the mesangial cells. See, in the circulation you are seeing antigen antibodies. They have come through the blood, and they are just coming and getting deposited within the subendothelium, in the viscera, in the mesangium. So this is the circulating immune complex. This is in situ, that is endothelial cells, basement membrane, and this is the food processes. See, that is visceral epithelial cells, food process. So probably some antigens are present in this visceral epithelial cells, antigens. These are the antigens. Through which, this is the endothelial cells and here is the blood. Through this blood, this immunoglobulins will come, get they just go and get attached to this food process antigens and forms antigen antibody complexes. This is called as in situ immune complex. So next is, what are the so there is a injury to the damage to the glomerulus. So what are the tests we are going to do? So mainly it is renal biopsy. Renal biopsy, there are again two types, percutaneous and open renal biopsy. Percutaneous is most commonly we do than open renal biopsy. And other, after that, once we come to know that there is a glomerular damage, injury to the glomerulus, then we go for the next test, that is immunofluorescence microscopy. And in this, there are two types of lesions we see, that is granular and linear forms of immune. This immune complex, it will get deposited in the glomerulus in the form of granules. Okay, there are certain granules, that is called as granular. And if it is present along the if it is present throughout in the linear, then it is called as linear type of immune complex deposition. So two patterns you see, granular and linear form of patterns, that is immunofluorescence. So now you saw that antigens and antibodies are deposited within the glomerulus. So what will happen next once they have got deposited? So once they have got deposited, they will go and, so once the antibodies are deposited to the mesangial cell antigens, so and mesangial cell antigens and antibodies are deposited, they will cause the lysis of mesangial cells, or they might release certain growth factors and lead to mesangial cell proliferation. And second, if there is a damage to the endothelial cells, it will cause endothelial injury and thrombosis. And then antibodies to the visceral, what will happen once there is a visceral epithelial cell damage? So as I told you, this is very important, visceral epithelial cell, endothelium and glomerular basement membrane, all three together is holding the constituents of the blood and only excretion of urine. But once there is a damage to this epithelial cells, then there is a damage to the glomerular filtration membrane. So because ideally proteins are not excreted, but here what happens, proteins also will get excreted because of damage to the, so there is a proteinuria. So and endothelial injury, then there is a platelet accumulation, aggregation and thrombus formations will occur once this antibodies will damage to the endothelial cells. The next, so I discussed about antibody mediated. It is very complicated. You people have to read again in depth. I prefer to read Robbins. In Robbins, it's given very neatly. And whatever class I've taken is from Robbins. So if you go through, it will be easy for you. Okay. Cell mediated immunity in glomerulonephritis. That is presence of macrophages, presence of sensitized T lymphocytes and their products in the glomerulus. So what will happen once there is a epithelial cell injury because of these drugs, toxins, antibodies? There is a changes in the epithelial cells, that is vacuolations, effacement of food processes, retraction and detachment of cells from the glomerular basement membrane. I will just show you this picture. So this is the food processes, glomerular basement membrane, endothelial cells with the endothelial cells, and this is the filtration membrane, and these are the addition molecules you are seeing. So what will happen once there is a antigen antibody deposition? There is a damage to this food processes. These food processes will get damaged. Either there it will become effacement of the food process, that is change in structure of the food process, or it will get detached from the membranes. Okay, so this will happen once there is a damage to the visceral epithelial cells. So next, what has happened now? As I told you, antigen antibody deposition and T cell immune reactions. So that is antibody mediated and T immune mediated cell mediated reactions. In this, antibody depositions, immune complexes, complement activations. So what happens once the immune complex is deposited in the glomerulus? There is a complement activation, and because of this complement activation, it will call for the neutrophils. Neutrophils, once it comes, it will release certain oxidants, cytokines, chemokines, and it will damage the glomerulus. Similarly, platelets will also come, and they will also adhere and aggregate and form again damage to the cells. Then macrophages will come. It will release growth factors, and again there is increased proliferation of mesangial cells, endothelial cells, and all. The mesangial cells will again get activated, and T cells will get activated. All these cells, once they get activated, and directly immune complexes might damage the epithelial, endothelial, mesangial. All together will damage the glomerulus and leads to injury to the glomerulus. So main, what happens once there is injury to the glomerulus? Same thing what I told you, inside to complex, circulating immune complex, activation of T lymphocytes, release of cytokines, chemokines, macrophage activations, mesangial cells activations, neutrophils, platelets, all together comes get deposited. Then they release free radicals, proteases and all, and damage to the glomerular diseases. So what happens once there is a damage to the glomerulus? So glomerular filtration membrane is hampered, and there is release of lot of proteins and other particles within the urine, and that leads to the damage to kidney damage. So once there is a damage to the glomerulus, the other tubules, interstitium are all interdependent. So damage to the tubules, that it will happen. So what happens once there is a damage to the glomerular damage? Once mainly this is a nephrotic syndrome. In nephrotic syndrome, what you are seeing, once there's a damage to the glomerulus, there is increased permeability of the capillaries to protein. So as I told you, proteins are not excreted, but once the glomerulus filtration membrane is damaged, there is increased proteins will come out, and that into it will go along with urine and leads to proteinuria. And once there is a proteinuria, then there is a decrease in the body. Hypoproteinemia will happen. That is usually proteinuria more than 3.5 grams. Then hypoproteinemia, it causes to the body. Once protein is less in the body, then it will lead to decreased plasma oncotic pressure. And once there is a oncotic pressure decrease, then fluids will escape into the tissue, leading to edema of these patients. And also there will be decreased plasma volume, decreased glomerular filtration rate, increased aldosterone secretions, fluid retentions. Altogether, once there is a reduction in proteins in the body, it leads to the edema, tissues within the edema. Fluid within the tissues will lead to the edema. And compensatory, once there is hypoproteinemia, there is increased production of compensatory synthesis of proteins, that is including lipoproteins, leads to hyperlipidemia. So this is the nephrotic syndrome, which it will, ideally it will go for nephritic or nephrotic syndromes. So now what are the syndromes associated with this glomerular damage? So glomerular syndromes. So once the glomerulus is damaged, injury to the glomerulus, it will cause either nephritic syndrome, nephrotic syndrome, rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis, chronic renal failure, or isolated urinary abnormalities. So what is this nephritic syndrome? Here there will be hematuria, azotemia, mild proteinuria, and hypertension. So usually these type of patients, they complain with hematuria, azotemia, mild proteinuria, and hypertension. So what do you mean by azotemia? I will just tell you. This is about the proteinuria and all. So here also there is a proteinuria. You find in the urine protein, but it is not more than 3.5 grams as you see in the nephrotic syndrome. Usually it will be more than 3.5 grams per day protein excretion in the urine. Hypoalbuminemia, hyperlipidemia, lipiduria, and rapidly progressive glomerulonephritis. You see proteinuria, hematuria, and acute renal failure, and chronic renal failure, azotemia, uremia, and isolated urinary abnormalities, hematuria or proteinuria. So these are the syndromes it is associated. So next class will be taken with nephritic syndrome, nephrotic syndrome, and then chronic renal failure. So what is azotemia? Azotemia clinical manifestations. Azotemia is nothing but that is increased blood urea creatinine levels will cause, and there's a decreased glomerular filtrations. So these will be excreted, that is increased urea and creatinine. So that is azotemia. When these urea and creatinine and decreased glomerular filtrations along with clinical signs, symptoms, biochemical abnormalities and involvements of GIT, peripheral nerves and heart, it is called as uremia. So these are the terms you should remember. So this completes glomerulonephritis classification. So classification, as I told you, it is mainly, so just a summary for 5 minutes. Classification, it is mainly based on clinical features. So it is again divided into acute and chronic and rapidly progressive type of glomerulonephritis. Then based on types, it is primary glomerulonephritis and systemic diseases associated with this glomerulonephritis and hereditary disorders. This is one type. And based on the histological type, it is again global, segmental, focal, and diffuse forms of glomerulonephritis, depending upon the involvement of the glomeruli. And you should know the normal structure of the glomerulus. It's a glomerular basement membrane, filtrations, and next, what are the pathogenesis? So in the pathogenesis, you are seeing it is mainly mediated by, it is immune mediated, that is, antibody mediated and cell mediated and activation of complement systems. So ultimately what has happened here is antigen and antibody gets deposited in the glomerulus, and this once it is deposited, body has to this glomerulus it has to be removed with the help of activation of complements, inflammatory cells, and all these cells will come and attack on the glomerulus to remove this antigen antibody, and so while removing it will damage the glomerulus and leading to glomerular injury and nephritis, glomerulonephritis. And with that, once this glomerulus is damaged, it might again go for damage to the tubules, blood vessels, interstitium, and that leads to chronic renal failure. From chronic renal failure, if it is repeated injury is happening, then it will go for end stage renal disease. Okay, so the symptoms, clinical features, what it mainly I talked about is azotemia and uremia, and further classes, nephritic syndrome, nephrotic syndrome, in that in detail they will teach about features. So this is the classification and pathogenesis. So mainly read about antigen, that is immune complex, immune mediated pathogenesis, you read on this. Okay, so this completes glomerulonephritis classification. Understood?